Good evening, everyone. Welcome to this event at the Magnus, sponsored by the Center for Jewish Studies. I'm Ben Brinner, I'm a professor in the Department of Music, and I'm the Helen Diller Family Director of the Center for Jewish Studies. Our speaker tonight, whom I will introduce properly in a moment, is the Helen Diller Family Visiting Israeli Scholar in Jewish Studies. But first, a few words about Helen Diller and her transformative contributions. The late Mrs. Diller attended Berkeley as an undergraduate, where she met her husband, Sanford. A compassionate and generous person, she helped further numerous worthwhile programs in the United States and in Israel. She deeply valued education and Jewish life and dedicated herself to sustaining both. We at the Center for Jewish Studies are exceedingly grateful to the Diller family for their significant endowment established through generous gifts by the Helen Diller Family Foundation some 15 years ago. We are honored to have been entrusted with this endowment, establishing the Helen Diller Family Program in Jewish and Israel Studies, which provides our campus with the means to support students, faculty, and the Center for Jewish Studies itself as a force for creating and transmitting scholarship on Jewish culture and history. And as I look around the room, I see at least a handful of graduate students here who are here partly because, or almost wholly because of the grants from this program. The endowment enables us to bring Israeli scholars such as Dr. Gil to Berkeley to engage with us. Our intellectual community is enriched through differing perspectives on Jewish cultural histories, productions, and practices, which often owe much to their formation in an Israeli academic environment. Just 2 days ago, I was joking that UC Berkeley is Tel Aviv University West. It's also Hebrew University West. The number of connections is truly astonishing. And they go both directions. So it's now my pleasure to introduce our speaker, Dr. Noam Gil. Noam is an author of academic and literary texts. He completed his dissertation titled The Burden of Identity, Holocaust Survivors in Jewish American Literature in 2015 at Tel Aviv University in the School of Cultural Studies, where he also lectured on American drama in the Department of English and American Studies. Noam is currently teaching a course on the Jewish Renaissance, in American literature between the years 1945 and 1970, a topic clearly linked to his dissertation. This is his second course at Berkeley. Last fall, he taught the work of prominent American Jewish writers and cultural figures, from Philip Roth to Woody Allen to Sarah Silverman. Engaging students from far afield, from engineering, biology, and other disciplines, with issues and content central to American Jewish cultural life and American cultural life in general. And to judge by the evaluations, they were fascinated by it. While at Berkeley, Noam has been drafting a book and writing articles. He has also been a catalyst for Jewish studies by creating a research group in which graduate students and postdoctoral fellows present and discuss their work and host leading scholars such as Professor Alter and Professor Kronfeld for a high-level discussion. Noam has a second career that I alluded to earlier as a playwright, an award-winning playwright, who has several plays that have already been performed in Tel Aviv and one coming up soon-ish, maybe after he gets back to Israel. This side of his work has enabled him to give expert guidance to a student-run course here at Berkeley titled Jewish Identity in 21st Century Theater, which Jewish Studies is proud to sponsor. It also gives him grounds to contribute to the conference that we'll be holding here in 2 weeks, Israeli Artists in Conversation with Israel. I'm just negotiating with him whether he'll have a role in this or not, to be presented by the Berkeley Institute for Jewish Law and Israel Studies in collaboration with our center and with the Magnus. Please mark your calendars for April 5th, 6th, and 7th. It'll start on the 5th in the evening and go through the 7th midday. Such an array of involvements is precisely what we hope for from visiting scholars such as Noam Gil, and I have to call out his predecessor in the position, Gilad Shavit, who both also has done great things for Jewish studies here. So now please join me in welcoming Noam, who we will speak on reclaiming the self in Jewish American culture.
Hi, everybody. Thank you all for coming. Thank you, Ben, for this lovely introduction. It was a lovely introduction. And I also want to thank the Helen Diller family and Jackie here for the generous contribution, valuable contribution to my research and to my actually coming here to Ben, to ETA. Thank you all so, so much. So let us begin. In Woody Allen's Deconstructing Harry, Harry Block, which is, who is played by Woody Allen, is a novelist who finds himself haunted by his own characters and their real-life counterparts, his parents, ex-wives, girlfriends, friends, etc. In the middle of a therapy session, one among many, Block is reminded by his analyst of a short story he once wrote, The Actor, about a protagonist who suddenly, in the middle of a movie shoot, literally goes out of focus. The director, the cameraman, and the set designer try all to understand why the actor could not be tuned back to focus, both through the camera lens and in real life. Since his family, co-workers, friends are helpless in his presence, his out-of-focusness gives them a headache, his doctor recommends him to supply his family members eyeglasses that will enable them to see him more clearly. The analyst of Harry Block reads the story as a cry of the novelist for his relatives and friends to conform to his own twisted sense of self, so the world could see the sharpness in an out-of-focus worldview. Later on in the movie, while his life is crumbling apart, Harry Block, the novelist, loses his own focus, blaring up in front of his companion. When Cookie, a prostitute he paid to supply meaningless sex, asks him if perhaps he overdosed on drugs, he admits that, and I quote, I didn't take any of that. I have nothing. It's me. I'm ODing on myself, end quote. The movie, upon its release, was perceived as Woody Allen's own defense against public accusations, a cinematic opportunity to settle scores with his worst enemies, investigative reporters, movie critics, his once friends turned into enemies, and perhaps most importantly, Woody Allen himself, haunted by his own demons. And yet, ODing on oneself relates to a cultural phenomenon which has become much more widespread than in Allen's movies. In this talk, I will discuss this unique predicament, overdosing on a relentless, endless, introspective inquiry into the self as a condition that has become prevalent in Jewish American culture and literature. Ever since the closing years of the 19th century, several Jewish American writers were already preoccupied with depicting a new Jewish character in America. A modern first-person singular eye who writes, speaks, and even thinks in English, turning his back to the old country in the East. The author, Mary Antin, for example, begins her autobiography, The Promised Land, with a striking statement, and I quote, I was born, I have lived, and I have been made over. Is it not time to write my life story? I am just as much out of the way as if I were dead, for I am absolutely other than the person whose story I have to tell. I could speak in the third person and not feel that I was masquerading. I can analyze my subject, I can reveal everything, for she, not I, is my real heroine. My life I have still to live, her life ended when mine began, end quote. It is a cultural transformation that, as Werner Solers already wrote, danced with, and I quote, with pronouns. The third person singular she spoke Yiddish and belonged to a world defined by faith and family. The first-person singular I is a modern individual who writes in often quite beautiful English, end quote. Other writers who wrote during the first half of the 20th century have introduced this new individual pursuing a new life in America, which is antithetical to the old one in Russia, Poland, Lithuania, and other parts in crumbling Eastern Europe. It is a painful transition that is often told in a nuanced and ambivalent manner, as if the old country still leaves traces on emancipated Jews in America. And yet, this story of immigration into the land of the free and the home of the brave is in most parts a happy one, or at least a promising one. This is not, however, our story today. And the Jewish self that is reclaimed once more in literature is one of an entirely different caliber. More specifically, I wish to discuss a tendency in 1950s and 1960s Jewish American literature to highlight the birth of a new character in fiction, a self-reflective, self-absorbed protagonist, exclusively male, implicitly or explicitly sharing sentiments of misogyny, consumed by obsessive inhibitions, sexually frustrated, infantile in nature, borderline delusional, a self-proclaimed bad husband, bad lover, bad son, bad Jew, a failure in life and a failure in art, an individual who is ODing on himself. In short, a self-indulgent Jewish character. It gets better. Jewish authors such as Saul Bellow, Philip Roth, Bernard Malamud, Norman Mailer, and Joseph Heller, all Jewish men writing predominantly about men victimized in varying ways by women, have all described in their novels and short stories characters who challenged or rejected various forms of social demands, indulging in infantile daydreaming, refusing to take part in serious matters or to commit to something that even they would consider to be significant. Some of them, as the late author David Foster Wallace observed, are, and I quote, the great male narcissists, part of the single most self-absorbed generation since Louis XIV. However, while Wallace and many others used self-indulgence as a denigrating term, many Jewish writers in America utilized this same tendency towards a social or cultural critique. Some, Malamud for example, used this new character, the self-centered individual, as a critique of the new generation of Jews growing up in non-Jewish America. Others celebrated this form of indulging in social trivialities as a subversive critique that was much required in these post-World War II years. I will focus here on two of the perhaps most discussed novels in Jewish American literature, written by authors that highlighted this predicament throughout their career. Philip Roth's and his notorious Portnoy's Complaint, published in 1969, and Saul Bellow and his perhaps most famous and successful Herzog, which was published in 1964. It should be noted first that while I'll be discussing novels that were written and published approximately during the same years, mid to the late 1960s, this tendency to portray self-indulgent Jewish character has become in recent years much more widespread and familiar. Jewish writers, directors, comedians, and performers such as Mel Brooks, Lenny Bruce, Sarah Silverman, Joel and Ethan Cohen, Jerry Seinfeld, Joan Rivers, Woody Allen, and Larry David have all performed, or at least staged, this highly suspicious role of the spoiled, politically indifferent, socially apathetic, decadent, and hedonistic character in their careers, mostly, though not exclusively, as standing for themselves. Masturbation, plastic surgery, bodily fluids, drugs, alcohol, bowling, consumerism, fornication, and worst of all, golfing, have become in these texts the new ideals to which these characters aspire. It is not an attempt to reject several stereotypes that were associated with the Jewish community in America throughout the years, but an effort, I believe, to use these same stereotypes to subvert several identitarian preconceptions. Bellow, Roth, and the aforementioned artists have all evoked in their works what the theorist Sian Yagai would call negative emotions, the same feelings that were abandoned or overlooked or perceived as minor by past aesthetic thinkers. These feelings are, and I quote from her study, immoral and non-cathartic, offering no satisfaction of virtue, however oblique, nor any therapeutic or purifying release. End of quote. So, instead of dramatic emotions such as anger, rage, fear, Nagai focuses on envy, irritation, and anxiety. Ugly feelings are not the stuff tragedies are made of, but involve existential pettiness, which many philosophers and artists try to avoid. In many instances, it is the image of powerful powerlessness, where the protagonist secludes himself from the outside world, immersed in a self-reflexive mode that always moves between dichotomist outlooks, sometimes affirming modes of social oppression, sometimes resisting an oppressive social order, frequently standing on the side of political struggles and adopting a framework of a disinterested commentator. Philip Roth's Portnoy Complain is still considered to be one of the most provocative and even ugly novels that a Jewish-American author has ever written. This confessional text is narrated by Alexander Portnoy to his imaginary therapist, Dr. Spielvogel. It is an incriminating, relentless, brutally honest indictment of the narrator against his parents, friends, girlfriends, rabbis, teachers, the sum total of the Jewish community in Portnoy's life. Portnoy's mother is depicted as the quintessential Jewish mother, inquisitive in nature, who spies on her afflicted son, constantly checking on his whereabouts. His father is far more helpless and powerless than his dominating wife, an emasculated father of a would-be emasculated son. For Portnoy, each encounter early in his life embodies the attributes and secrets of the Jewish community in Newark. It is an element which Portnoy immediately and repeatedly associates with his given identity as a Jewish boy growing up in suburban America. His complaint against his community in New Jersey is a furious one. And I quote, "Instead of wailing for he who has turned his back on the saga of his people, weep for your own pathetic selves, why don't you? Sucking and sucking on the sour grape of religion. Jew, 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 Jew. It is coming out of my ears already, the saga of the suffering Jews. Do me a favor, my people, and stick your suffering heritage up your suffering ass. I happen also to be a human being. Trust me, I'm giving you the PG version of Portnoy's complaint. And I think not a lot of people talk about it, but I think it's a novel which is unique in its abundance of exclamation points. And I'm trying to convey this style in my reading. Roth is much more disrespectful and less forgiving than his predecessors, introducing Jewish chutzpah that remained unrivaled in Jewish American literature. For him, being a Jewish individual is an inescapable condition one must deal with. Look, and I'm quoting again, am I exaggerating to think it's practically miraculous that I'm ambulatory? The hysteria and the superstition, the watch-its and the be-carefuls. You mustn't do this, you can't do that. Hold it. Don't. You're breaking important law. What law? Whose law? It's a family joke that when I was a tiny child, I turned from the window out of which I was watching a snowstorm and hopefully asked, Mama, do we believe in winter? Imagine what my conscience gave me for all that jerking off. Jerking off, or more specifically, as Roth titles one of the most discussed and ugly parts in the novel, whacking off, have become the main theme in the novel. A protagonist who shamefully admits that half my waking life I spend locked behind the bathroom door. Self-gratification, a crucial theme in Roth's novel and in its protagonist's life, is depicted as a disgraceful act, indicating the lack of control and unbearable sense of guilt that follows Portnoy's life since his adolescent years. It is also repeatedly situated against glorious narrative of Western culture. He identifies himself as the Raskolnikov of jerking off and his house as some false version of William Shakespeare's King Lear with me, that is Portnoy in the role of Cordelia. His sexual tendencies are repeatedly depicted as a Jewish source of shame and situated within a non-Jewish American context which idealizes an independent, hardworking, noble and respectful individuality. And I quote again, in school we chanted along with our teacher, I am the captain of my fate, I am the master of my soul. And meanwhile, within my own body, an anarchic insurrection has been launched by one of my privates which I was helpless to put down. This same lack of control and decreasing independence also highlights the subversive element in this ugly act. I return here to Sienna Guy's Ugly Feelings, where in her study she discusses Herman Melville's short story Bartleby the Scrivener, a story of Wall Street, which was published in 1853. In this short story, Melville depicts the life of a scrivener, a one-time hard-working clerk who suddenly, one day, decides to respond to his boss's requests by simply saying, I would prefer not to. For Nagai, Bartleby's automatic and mysterious antagonistic sentiments relate to the autonomous place of art. Secluded from the outside world, separated from empirical reality. Bartleby's character embodies an explicit awareness of his inability to change society, remaining solely in a self-reflective mode. In that sense, art is privileged in its self-reflexivity. Portnoy's continuous refusal is not aimed towards action, preferring not to do, but to literally join hands, to share a life, to make love, to express mutual understanding. Throughout the novel, Portnoy describes masturbation as the defining characteristics of his narration, a monologist complaint addressed to an imaginary psychoanalyst, a therapeutic attempt to cure himself of his sordid beliefs and actions, and I'm quoting again. All I do is complain. The repugnance seems bottomless, and I'm beginning to wonder if maybe enough isn't enough. I hear myself indulging in this kind of ritualized belly aching that is just what gives psychoanalytic patients such a bad name to the general public. Is it truth I'm delivering up, or is it just plain kvetching? Or is kvetching, for people like me, a form of truth? Portnoy here is addressed both as the narrator, the protagonist, and the audience at the same time in this never-ending cycle of kvetching, or whining. It is again a distinct kind of kvetching that Portnoy cynically identifies with his political implications. And I quote again, "Is this human misery? I thought my life was going to be loftier, dignified suffering, meaningful suffering. Sometimes perhaps along the line of Abraham Lincoln. Tragedy, not farce. Sometimes little more Sophoclean was what I had in mind. The great emancipator, and go on. It surely never crossed my mind that I would wind up trying to free from bondage nothing than my own, you know what. Let my Peter go. There, that's Portnoy complain. That's the story of my life all summed up in four heroic dirty words. A travesty. My politics descended entirely to my pants. The freak I am, the lover of no one and nothing, unloved and unloving." End of quote. His self-gratifying tendency of becoming the novel not only a typical juvenile mode of behavior of a young man exploring his sexuality, they are also a metaphor for the literary act, a long kvetching in a form of writing done inside the secluded spaces of one's mind and one's room. This widespread ugliness and absorption into the self stand against the nature not only of American ideals, but also, as the last chapter in the novel shows, against Zionist ideals as well. While trying to cure himself of his existential predicament, Portnoy goes to Israel to perhaps meet a woman who will redeem him from his condition. But, alas, Portnoy cannot perform. He finds himself helpless sexually in front of an Israeli military officer, a doer, who celebrates Israeli independence. Portnoy, to the female officer, is an ideal example of an infantile, self-hating individual. His inability to perform sexually resonates once more to cultural and political arenas, an embodiment of a diasporic, ghettoized Jewishness that prefers not to. Portnoy is, to be sure, not a representative Jewish American individual, if such a thing exists. He is a source of shame not only to himself, but to his community, to his family, to his race, to himself, relishing in a point of view of social indifference. All he has left is his endeavors to sharpen his penis or pencil. Philip Roth nourishes on what he perceives to be his protagonist's personal demon, being a sexually obsessed Jewish young man unable to affirm non-Jewish ideals, for example, unable to indulge in meaningful suffering. Similarly, Saul Bellow goes into an in-depth exploration of his protagonist's afflictions, delving into the source of his misery. And yet, while in Roth's novel, the disease and the cure constantly coincide, in Bellow's, the attempt to narrate his protagonist's borderline madness is by no means therapeutic, but only increases the troubling disease from which Hurst tries so hard to be cured. The whole novel is an attempt of its protagonist, Professor Moses Elkanah Herzog, to make sense of a senseless existential affliction. His life is deteriorating rapidly after being abandoned by an unfaithful wife who had an affair with his best friend. Herzog shuts himself in his own house, away from a hostile world, writing unanswered letters. It is, as in Portnoy's complaint, a desire to write oneself into long, almost deliberately excruciating monologues, devoid of a concrete audience and a concrete conclusion. Herzog, once a happily married man, holding a coveted position at Chicago University, gradually loses control over his life. The analytic endeavors start immediately at the beginning of the novel, and I quote, "He admitted that he had been a bad husband, twice. To his son and his daughter, he was a loving but bad father. To his parents, he had been an ungrateful child. To his country, an indifferent citizen. To his brothers and his sister, affectionate but remote. With his friends, an egotist, with love, lazy, with brightness, dull, with power, passive, with his own soul, evasive." End quote. At the beginning of the novel, Herzog hits rock bottom, stranded alone in his 19th century house, sharing his food with a hungry rat nearby. All that is left for him is writing obscure letters to individuals who will never read them, to his ex-wives, to his parents, to American presidents, to himself, to dead philosophers such as Martin Heidegger, Friedrich Nietzsche, Søren Kierkegaard, and several others. He's also writing a scholarly book about Romanticism and Christianity that he will never finish. While Herzog is determined to explain, to have it out, to justify, to put in perspective, to clarify, to make amends, these same analytic endeavors become throughout the novel a bottomless pit, and I quote, "Believing that reason can make steady progress from disorder to harmony and that the conquest of chaos need not be begun anew every day. How I wish it, how I wish it were so, how Moses prayed for this," end quote. Herzog's life, as well as his writing, is literally a mess. After being left alone, he becomes consumed by a process of self-examinations that only intensify his existential detachment. He writes to dead people, changing points of view, repeatedly changing his mind within the same sentence. The pen and the man are constantly juxtaposed as two entities that, and I quote, "enact the peculiarities of life," end quote. Again, similar to Portnoy, he is both the patient in the story and the doctor, and his medical tools, the act of narration or the process of writing letters, are also extremely poisonous and inspirational at the same time. Professor Herzog typifies Saul Bellow's long preoccupation with intellectuals who become suspicious towards their intellectual preoccupation. Herzog condemns the silly talk of scholarly people, quote, announcing that the world should love, and I quote again, "should love lovers but not theoreticians, never theoreticians, show them the door, ladies, throw out these gloomy bastards," end quote. At first, Herzog wishes to distinguish between the essentials and the random facts of life, showing how life could be lived by renewing universal connections, revising the old Western Faustian ideology, investigating the social meaning of nothingness, end quote. As a true yet delusional intellectual, he strives for an awareness that will clarify its object of curiosity. And yet, this desire only increases his detachment from empirical reality. His despair throughout the novel makes him pray to God to remove this great bone, and I quote, "bone-breaking burden of selfhood and self-development. Give himself a failure back to the species of a primitive, give himself a failure back to the species of a primitive cure," end quote. Bellow explicitly associates this bone-breaking burden of the selfhood with academic research and defines Professor Herzog as a victim of his own profession. Herzog identifies himself throughout his narration as a narcissist, conceited egomaniac, unable to distinguish between trivialities and the essentials. The tools of his profession are insufficient and misleading, word games, the problem rather than the solution for a troubled man. Bellow's protagonist is also ODing on himself, unable to relieve himself from the surgery table, dissecting a tormented, deconstructed, convoluted body that will perish if left on the surgery table. It is literally depicted as a medical procedure gone terribly wrong. As Russell's Portnoy, Herzog indulges in his own failure, in his own suffering, in his own disorienting state of mind, in his own mess. He's literally writing or theorizing himself almost to death. While Philip Roth was considered immediately after the publication of Portnoy's complaint as the enemy of the Jewish people in America by some, Bellow was still and still is perceived as its biggest pride. It's the only Jewish American author who won the Nobel Prize for Literature, not counting Isaac Bashevis Singer, but it's a topic unto itself. Roth's depiction of Jews was characterized as a direct and merciless attack that supports anti-Semitic point of view of on his people as sexually depraved, asocial, and amoral individuals. The novel's popularity only increased the animosity of many Jewish individuals towards Roth. Roth himself stated later that, and I quote, "The man in my novel is confessing to forbidden sexual acts and gross offenses against the family order and ordinary decency of Jewish life. Going vile in public is the last thing in the world that a Jew is expected to do," end of quote. Saul Bellow's Herzog, contrarily, is still considered to be one of the most celebrated novels in Jewish American literature, perhaps second perhaps only to the adventures of Augie March, another novel published in 1953 by Bellow. While Bellow's protagonist still embodies a sensibility which was both distinctly Jewish and universal at the same time, Roth highlights a Jewish community that will never transcend its own Jewishness. Both novels, Portnoy's Complaint and Herzog, dramatize in certain parts non-dramatic events, men engaging in self-analysis, indulging in private spaces with private matters. ODing on oneself relates here to the ambivalent condition of each character, which both destroys the protagonist and gives meaning to his sense of self. Being out of focus, it seems, is as sharp as they could ever be. Thank you. If anyone have anything to ask, add. We have here Tomer.
Hi. I wonder if, I guess the question is, how did or did World War II contribute to the male characters in the 50s and 60s?
Great question. It's a great question that I almost think that giving it an answer would do a big injustice to oversimplify it in that manner. 5 or 6 years after Saul Bellow published Herzog, he published another novel called Mr. Sumner's Planet about a Holocaust survivor living in 1960s New York, and it was also contextualized within the tumultuous times of the 1960s in America. And in it, he defines Semler, and in certain regards, he defines many of his characters as some sort of victims of action, as if the first half of the 20th century was such a horrific times for Jews. His characters were unique in the sense that they didn't do much, specifically in compared to other characters in American fiction, like Hemingway's characters and so on, where they head-on confronted political conflicts. So Saul Bellow's, in that sense, expressed some sort of a reservation from this point of view of a doer, somebody who takes action. In that sense, this is something which I, at least in my mind, it is a direct response to the Holocaust and to the actions that were implemented on Jewish people and the rest of humanity, at least in Europe.
I'm wondering if I'm also interested in the question, it's a little slightly different question, of these authors that you're studying and their reaction to the 60s, which also saw a great involvement, at least among Jewish youth, in the political, particularly the civil rights struggle at the time, and other political moves, the anti-war movement in this country. So in that context, I'm thinking of American Pastoral, which is a later novel, I mean, I don't know the date really, that Roth wrote, and it seems to be a critique of, a dissing of the 60s in certain ways. I guess if I would just like you to comment on that novel in light of what you've said about Roth.
I would be honest, I read it a while ago. I can comment about, and I could give you an answer, but I don't think that it would be an adequate one. Uh-huh. I could, the 60s is an extreme theme input, as I see it, is in all the 60s and all of its political implication, all of the things that were happening in the streets, for me at least, a crucial theme in Portnoy's complaint, in the sense that it is like the dog that didn't bark. Uh-huh. The 60s are not in Portnoy's complaint. Right. And not only that the novel was published in 1969, during the Vietnam years, and it was during the Make Love, Not War generation, both Roth and Sol Bellow explicitly had a growing animosity towards the 1960s flower anti-establishment generation. But Roth, in the sense that not only excluding the 60s from his novel, but deliberately and explicitly not making love, or what he does in the novel is not make love, but either he engages in some sexual practices which are far different from what the Make Love Not War had in mind, but only aside from that, going into the bathroom, and as I said before, literally refusing to join hands in some sort of a social solidarity, is something which I consider to be some sort of a literary defiance to this urge for social commitment, which he expresses in his writing and other sordid actions. Sol Bellow, I mentioned before, Mr. Sumner's Planet. Mr. Sumner's Planet is a direct attack on the 1960s generation, which for Bellow, they took, Bellow considered himself to be a liberal, but he could not conform to anti-establishment movements and set of beliefs, and for him he wrote a specific book that targets this movements during the 1960s.
Noam, I think all the lines of similarity you drew between Portnoy and Herzog are quite convincing, but don't you think that there is something else in Herzog that you don't find in Portnoy? What I'm thinking of is, with all the self-negation and being at cross purposes with yourself, and that wonderful phrase you pick up from Woody Allen, ODing on yourself. Toward the end, when Herzog is alone in his house in the Berkshires, and I think it's springtime, it's been a while since I've read the book, and you know, he feels the sunlight and is aware of nature burgeoning, and then he writes a letter to God, and he says, "Hineni, here I am. I'm ready for your call." And that seems to me to be a kind of existential affirmation, which I don't see in Roth.
Yeah. Yeah, you're right. Roth is much more, is much less nuanced and much more exclamation point kind of writer than Saul Bellow is. When I read the novel, I had the sense that Herzog stands out from all of it. It is something which typifies all of Saul Bellow's, or at least many of Saul Bellow's novels. There is some sort of a deep connection between him and I'm hesitant to say God, but some sort of a deep connection, because in Herzog I think it's much more ambivalent. In, for example, in Mr. Samuel's Planet, it's much more straightforward. But there is some sort of a deep personal connection between him and God, which specifically rejects or excludes society from the picture, as if he is conducting in some sort of some form of a deeply private and almost intuitive dialogue, which in its essence conveys something which is truthful, and yet society is out of the picture for both Herzog and other characters as well. Bellow is much more forgiving than Philip Roth towards his protagonists, at least comparing Herzog and Portnoy. Yeah, I agree.
First, thank you, Noam, for a wonderful talk. It was really fascinating. I want to ask you a question about, I think your reading of the two novels is really fascinating, and I think the fact that you insist on limiting the scope on male authors who write in English allows you to tell a fascinating story. I'm just curious what happens if we expand the scope and we look at women authors like Grace Paley or authors who write in languages different than English, like Bashevis. Because I look at Grace Paley, you know, her protagonists, they are bad mothers, bad lovers, bad daughters.
They're never self-indulgent.
Right.
Well, never is a strong word, but there rarely, if any, are share these self-indulgent tendencies, and specifically when you compare authors such as Cynthia Ozick or Grace Paley to this gang of the Roth, Bellow, Mailer of course stands out. Grace Paley didn't conceal her hatred towards not only towards the writing of this group of men, but more specifically being associated under what she perceived to be a deeply suspicious category of Jewish American novel or Jewish American writer. She always said, "I'm not part of them. They are more my enemy than my my friends. And when I look at them, and again, I don't want to romanticize, and I don't want to justify, and I don't want to argue for some of the statements that some of which I read and some of which I kind of deliberately neglected to mention." But she said that when I read the stories, I feel more as a woman than I ever did. I mean, this is their contribution to Grace Paley's sense of identity. Being as a reader, being in a place of being attacked or being like that.
Again, a wonderful talk. Thank you so much. I was wondering about this self-indulgence that you were talking about, and because at points it seems that this is a narcissist self-indulgence. And at points, it seems masochistic. And it seems like they're kind of like a turn in between, always this enjoyable and hateful reality. And I was, if you can say something about that, if you identify the same movement and what that means.
First of all, I have to say that I have this deep urge that whenever you guys ask me a question, I have this automatic need to ask you back, and because I have a sense that your contribution to what I have to say, I'm eager to hear. But self-indulgence is something which is, especially with Philip Roth and with Saul Bellow, is sometimes associated with self-hatred. It's not like these are contradictory terms. Narcissism is, again, self-hatred is there is this what has once been a quite influential study called The Age of Narcissism, which was published in 1979 by Christopher Lash, who says that narcissism and self-hatred are two sides of the same coin, as if they go together. So if there were a map, I would draw some sort of a scheme, then I would show that there is subcategories to what I refer to as self-indulgent. But in Bellow's case, for example, and in Roth's case, the fact that he always says that what I'm doing here is I'm kvetching, I'm always kvetching and kvetching and kvetching, and I'm kvetching about my life as a Jewish young boy in America. So this kvetching or this belly aching or arguing against oneself is a form of self-indulgent, or it is perceived or described in the novels as a form of self-indulgence.
I'm curious whether their reaction or expression of who they are has anything to do with any conflict between feeling like they want to assimilate and feeling like they are being, I guess, feeling anti-Semitism or feeling like they are of the other, if there's any kind of conflict there.
That's a great question. There are a lot of hilarious parts in Philip Roth when he says that as a young adolescent, a typically adolescent boy, what he wanted was to have sex. And he wanted to have sex with women who were distinctly non-Jewish. And he gives this, for him, sexually speaking, this was the form of assimilation which he so wanted to achieve. He has all of these hilarious parts when he invents himself, not as a Portnoy, but as a Père Noir, a French-American, distinctly non-Jewish, who will succeed in the help of his Frenchness to have sex. And these forms of assimilation are stuff which are are an essential part of his existence as a young Jewish boy in America. This is the story, the fact that what I'm telling you here is a failed attempt to assimilate into the American scene. Especially again, 1960s and all of the political consequences of it. With Saul Bellow, assimilation is much less paramount. It's something which is much less straightforward. It seems that Herzog doesn't have issues with his Jewishness. And this is why. One of the reasons why Bellow was more the darling of the Jewish community in America, the fact that he manages to give some sort of a universal standpoint, which is Jewish and non-Jewish at the same time. So Roth was much more conflicted about it than Bello.
Noam, thank you for an elegant, entertaining talk, and feel free to ask me a follow-up question if you,
I will.
Or don't. I wanted to ask about the role of the viewer or the reader in all of this, because it strikes me that when, is it Deconstructing Harry, when he says that he's out of focus, it's not only sort of a demand for his family members to accommodate him, but also it brings the viewer into a consciousness of what is doing the focusing, right, of the extra diegetics, the camera.
Yeah.
And I'm wondering if that sort of collapse also functions with Roth and Bello, in the sense that with Roth, in Portnoy's complaint, if I remember, the analyst only says like one thing at the end, right? Or the analyst is never named.
The analysis can begin, something like that.
Yeah, at the end, right?
Yeah.
And in a sense, we don't know as readers that it's addressed to the analyst. And it, like, we might think it's addressed to us.
My belief is the analyst doesn't exist. It's an imaginary. One thing which typifies both novels is the fact that they are both writing or complaining to an addressee who will never read their complaint. There is no analyst. Herzog writes letters to dead people, to Martin, Martin Heidegger was alive during those days, but Friedrich Nietzsche, Freud, Kennedy, and others. So in that sense, there is this, the whole notion of writing one's life is a monologue which doesn't take under consideration the fact that there are readers. So in that sense, there is a rejection of the fact that I'm delivering something. It's like a message in a bottle that will never get into, will never arrive to its destination. That's it, and that is why, for example, masturbation, as I was talking later on, is the quintessential metaphor for what Portnoy was doing. The fact that there is no form of message who will get to some form of addressee. What I'm doing is something which is done in the seclusion of my own room and my own mind.
So you wouldn't accept a reading that the addressee of those letters is also in some sense the reader? Like the reader in no way interrupts that kind of solipsism.
The writer is Herzog and Portnoy. The subject of narration is the narration itself. It is the complaint or writing letters. And the addressee is Herzog and Portnoy. That is why it is, introduces some form of a never-ending cycle of narration, conducting almost a dialogue with himself in certain regards. I hope that I clarified.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Thank you.
Wrote Goodbye Columbus,
yeah,
which the Jewish community accepted, but the critics treated it as a very lightweight book. And my impression, going back to when I first read it, when it first came out, was that he wrote Portnoy's Complaint for shock value. And he was accepted much, then he could
You're saying it like it's a bad thing. No, I'm
no, joking. But it gave him exposure. And then he could develop Zuckerman, who is his alter ego, and Portnoy grows up into Zuckerman.
Yeah. First of all, I'm reminded by a lovely quote. There was a movie actress, maybe it was Elizabeth Taylor or Anne Margaret or something, that after the novel was published, it was such a success that she said that I would love to meet Philip Roth, but I wouldn't like to shake his hand. Goodbye Columbus was published when he was 26 years old, and it was, compared to Portnoy's Complaint, it was rather mellow, but it was also a provocative short story collection that infuriated a lot of people in the Jewish community in America, the way in which it depicted the Jewish community as, or Jewish individuals as individuals who individuals who were not portrayed in a flattering manner. And that was the issue that, that was what bothered Roth so much, the fact that I didn't conform to what you perceive Jewish individuals are all about. But I agree with you. At least and now I'm not only speaking as a scholar, but as a playwright. Goodbye Columbus was an okay hit. It was 26 years old, and it was a very, very good book published when you're 26 years old, and then he suffered few failures. He published two novels, and what I sensed is exactly what you thought, that I need something that people could not ignore. And it was such a success, and it was such a hit, that Philip Roth later on became haunted by it. And even now there is this joke among the community, why does Philip Roth doesn't, each year he's on the, one of the, he's shortlisted for the Nobel Prize, and each year he doesn't get it, and now that they gave the prize to to Bob Dylan, it seems like the Nobel Prize wanted to make sure that Roth will know that he will never get the Nobel Prize ever. And Philip Roth blames Portnoy's Complaint for it. He says that the reason why I didn't or I will never get the Nobel Prize as such, this coveted award, is because I dared to write this obnoxious, obscene, wonderful novel. Yeah. Okay, okay. Yeah. Thank you so much. Thank you so much.